Go ahead and be seated. Let's pray together. God, we come before you, Lord, and we ask for you to speak to us today. Lord, we ask for your Holy Spirit to move in our lives. Lord, I'm begging of you for the words that come from the mouth of my heart, that they reflect your word and your glory. And God, there are folks that maybe aren't even here today that will watch online or hear this on a podcast. All over the globe, people tune in. There might be someone that we're thinking of today that could really use this message. And so God, I pray that you would get the word out. And Lord, that you would bring transformation in people's lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, today we're finishing up on the fruit of the Spirit. And we're going to be looking at the last element here called self-control. And I like the way Proverbs 21:17 puts it. It says this. It says, whoever loves pleasure will be a poor man. He who loves wine and oil will not be rich. It's this idea of not being able to hold back from our passions and our desires, that they so consume us that the pleasures of this world, they take priority in our lives. I think a lot of us have self-control issues in many different arenas of our lives. Growing up, I think I am the reason why you, as a teenager, if you're a kid here today, you can't get your driver's license in the state of New Mexico until you're 16 years old. It's because of me and my friends. Because we could get our driver's license when we were 15, when I was growing up. And I had my best friend Troy, and he was 14. He wasn't even 15 yet. And we loved God. We went to church. We helped out. And I finally got my driver's license. My parents gave me the keys to their Jeep Cherokee. I loved that 4.0 little Jeep Cherokee. I would take it romping and off-roading anywhere I could. My parents didn't know about that. And so I got to go to church one morning because I was doing a skit for our student ministry. And we had two church services, like a 9:30 and 11. And my buddy and I, we got done with the skit. We're like, let's get out of here. We got to go to Walgreens to get gum. Why? Because we can. We have a driver's license. We have freedom. We have independence. Never mind the speed limit that's set. I didn't have to go, but a quarter of a mile to the Walgreens to get gum. And we went, we got our gum, and we walked around, and we strutted our stuff. We felt so big, so bad, and in control. And the voice of my mom and dad in the background that would say, drive the speed limit. Be responsible. Driving is a privilege, not a right. Oh, that was just background noise. I could hardly hear that as I stepped into my car and turned my stereo volume up as loud as it possibly would go. And I'm racing up Harper, right down the street, going 65 in a 40. Now, I'm not setting any NASCAR records here, but I blaze by and I hear a siren of a cop car in the background. Then I look to my friend, I say, some dummy's getting pulled over. Glad that's not us. And I keep going up the street. And it felt like it was in the distance because I was just going so fast. I didn't know that there was a police car trailing me. And I got a Jeep Cherokee, so I pull into Hoffmantown Church's parking lot. That's a big parking lot. It's where I would learn how to drive, and it's where I would get my first speeding ticket. I hopped over the curve to cut across the parking lot to save time. Not because I needed to, but because I could. And around the loop came a cop car with the sirens blaring. And he gave me his little stop, and it looked like a T because his car was out front. He got out of the vehicle, told me to get out of the vehicle. And I stepped out of the car wondering, what just happened? They've got the wrong guy. Somebody stole someone's Jeep Cherokee that looks like mine. The police are after me. And then what happens? In Jesus' name, amen. You guys have a good week. We'll see you next week. Church lets out. So about 1,500 people let out. And the cop car is right there with me and my parents' car. And I'm standing there talking to a police officer getting my very first ticket. I didn't get to go to church that next hour. I didn't get to do the service. I had to go home and face my punishment. And You know, it took me some time to learn a little bit of self-control in driving. I remember I was punished. I couldn't hang out with my friend. I said, he didn't do anything wrong. He told me to slow down. I didn't listen to him. I do what I please. I got to take away my driver's license for a while. I had to face some punishment. I had to face some consequences in order to develop some self-control and responsibility back in my life. And I think that many of us here today, we face all kinds of self-control issues. We face these issues that Proverbs talk about where we love pleasure so much so that we will spend what we don't have in order to fulfill our desires. It's this idea of pleasure, of doing what we want right here, right now, when we want, that takes over the self-control. You know, maybe you don't suffer with speeding like I do. Maybe your issues of self-control are different. I'm willing to bet that here in this room and all across America that people deal with self-control every single week. It just looks different for every person. Maybe you're a binge watcher on Netflix. You cannot help yourself. You sign up and you're thinking $9.99 a month. I'll watch maybe a couple shows. That'll get my money's worth. And then you find out some show has got every episode of every season on, and you get sucked in to the Netflix vortex. And you go with well intentions to watch one movie. And that turns into a whole series, an episode, and you just keep watching it. And then you're thinking to yourself, I've got to do something with my life here. Why am I still watching Netflix? It's 2 in the morning. You got to get up at 6 to go to work. But they've got that little 15-second countdown that says next episode will start in 15 seconds. And you cannot decide what to do with your life in 15 seconds. You can't make a productive decision in 15 seconds. So click, it just begins, and then you are hooked. Finally, you turn off the computer. Netflix is over. You've just binged an entire season. You step out into the world and you see the sunlight and your eyes crack open and you sheer back and you want to just go watch some more Netflix, don't you? Self-control. Maybe others, it's more serious. It's dealing with internet pornography or an addiction to sex outside of God's plan for marriage, and it controls you, controls your thoughts. It controls your thinking, your emotions, the direction of your life, every waking moment. It is a battle that you are facing. For some, it's the greed factor. I mean, Black Friday has now become a weekend experience. You know, it's no longer Black Friday, it's Black Weekend, and there's Cyber Monday, and there's, you know, these Saturday shopping for those who are small businesses, and they just keep you going and going and going, and you cannot resist a deal. You go into that store, and you're not even thinking clearly. You're just looking at clearance with the price tag, 50% markdown off. You gotta get it. So you keep going. You see your friends around you, and they're able to purchase newer, larger homes, put expansions on their homes, and the greed gets you, because you've got no self-control. We all face self-control issues. And a lot of us have a very wrong understanding of what God's plan for self-control can be in our lives. We come at it with the idea that we just need to have more self-control. If I could learn to say no, if I could simply resist the temptation. I want to teach you guys a very deep, I believe, theological truth about God. Hebrews says that he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. The Word of God tells us that Jesus faced temptation just like you and I, but was without sin. God's perfect holiness equals perfect self-control. And I think, well, yeah, he was God. He never sinned. I want to teach you something about Jesus. He came here and he was subject to the same rules of law in order for here on earth. He had to eat. He had to sleep. He entered the world. And he plugged himself right here. But Jesus never did sin, never would have sin, never will sin, because of his perfect holiness. The deep theological truth here is Jesus cannot sin. He cannot sin. There is nothing inside of the God-man Jesus when he came in here and came and lived that life. There was nothing in him that was ever attracted to sin, that would ever sin. So Jesus had perfect self-control issues because he was holy. He was perfect. Now, a lot of us go about, we think, well, we just need more self-control in our lives. And if we could have better self-control, we would be better people. But that's not true. We don't need more self-control. We need more of Jesus. You know, studies have been done on self-control. A New Zealand scientist studied middle school kids all the way through to adulthood. And we think that some people are just smart. And they're smarter than others. And they're just, those are the ones who are going to do really well in school. They practiced a little test on these kids. And they said, hey, I've got a dollar for you. I'd like to give you a dollar right here and right now, this very moment. But I'm coming back next week. And if you wait till next week, it'll double to $2. The kids who could wait till the very next week and take the $2 and exercise self-control, they had better test scores. They were less likely to get arrested. They had better socialization. The kids who practiced self-control succeeded and did well. Now, some of you think, well, gosh, I'm that person who's going to take the dollar right then and there. How do I get a grip on self-control? Now, Galatians 5 talks about the fruit of the Spirit. The fruit of the Spirit. Verse 23, last week we looked at God's goodness a few weeks ago, and now we see self-control. And against such things, there is no law. You want to know how to get self-control? It's found in Christ. You know, Paul uses this word here in the Greek language, and it's only used in two other places in the New Testament. It's kind of a difficult word. It's used in Acts chapter 24. Peter uses it in one of his letters. But it's not the idea of mastering something. It's the idea of being mastered by someone. You know, in order to get control of your life, you actually got to lose control. You got to give up control. In order to gain control, you have to give up control. In order to gain control in your life over those issues that you're facing, you have to give your life over to God. You have to give Him control of your life. You know, my kids, they love remote control cars. They love them so much. They get out there and they love to play with remote control cars because they get to be the ones in control of the car. Where the car goes is based upon where my kids tell it to go. If you just picked up the remote control car and you didn't have the remote, the car's just going to sit there. It's not going to make any traction. It's not going to gain any ground. You need the remote. In many ways, that's what the Holy Spirit does with us and for us. He is the one who is in control. He leads us. Paul uses a similar word in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 25. He says, every athlete exercises self-control in all things. They do it to receive a perishable wreath, but we an imperishable wreath. Or you might think of a crown or prize. That an athlete will train his body. He will sacrifice eating pumpkin pie at Thanksgiving. Some of us are dealing with the self-control issues of our weight post-Thanksgiving. You know, we ate an entire pumpkin pie and added 10 pounds of pumpkin pie around our waistline. And we go to the doctor, and we are at the doctor on the scale, and the doctor says, well, you have a weight problem. And you just say, no, I don't have a weight problem. I have a vision problem. And you suck in your gut, and you can see the scale numbers again. An athlete will forego and do crazy things to gain an edge and get a pie. They want that piece of the pie. They want the prize. I read stories about great Olympians like Michael Phelps and how he trains his body, the exercise regimen that a swimmer will do and go through. It's unbelievable the amount of time, effort, energy that they put into self-control. And 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 9, Paul uses self-control again. He says, but if they cannot exercise control, they should marry, for it's better for them to marry than to burn with passion. Paul is giving advice to singles here that they should get married, that they should pursue marriage if they are struggling with sexual purity, that they should not try and live the single life, that they should ask God to bring them someone and be married and enjoy the fruits of being married. Paul uses these similar words to show us the concept of control in our lives. But it's in Galatians 5:16 that we see how God wants to take control so that we can have control. First, it says this. It says, but I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. Before Paul gets into the fruit of the Spirit, what's produced in a believer's life, he tells the believers that they've got to walk by God's Spirit. That's the idea of losing control, of raising the white flag, of surrendering to God, saying, God, your plan, your ways are better than mine. And I submit my life to you. I need you to take control. There's a college student in Lubbock, Texas, and he was facing a final exam, and the professor saw the midterm scores and decided that he was going to give those students an opportunity to do better on the final exam. So he told them, each of you can bring an 8.5 piece of paper by 11, and you can write anything you want down on that piece of paper. You put anything you want on that paper, and you can bring it with you into the exam. So all of his classmates are furiously writing down notes on this sheet of paper. But he had a little trick up his sleeve. On the day of the exam, everyone had been studying and preparing and writing their notes down, and they were perplexed to see that this student walked in with a blank piece of paper. They said, you know the test well enough? You're gonna be good? He says, no. He puts the piece of paper down, and he gets his buddy, who got an A+ in the class from the semester before, and he placed him on that sheet of paper and began to take the exam. And the professor said, son, I'm sorry, you can't be in this class. We're taking a final exam. And the young man said, you said I could put anything I want on this piece of paper. So they had a little conversation, and he got an A. You know, I think the difficulty about the Christian life is we don't take advantage of what's right in front of us. We're like the rest of the kids in the class. We're furiously trying to do it on our own. We're writing everything we know how down to overcome our issues of self-control. And we so desperately want to succeed and do well, and we want to do it on our own because that's how we were raised. We were raised that way. We were raised to become independent, to leave the nest. We were raised to do it on our own, not to take help from anybody else. We live in America. There's a lot of self-made people here in America. We view ourselves as intelligent people, and we can do this. And so we furiously work so hard on these issues. And we wonder why we're still struggling with lust. And we wonder why we're still struggling with greed. And we wonder why we're still struggling with our weight. And we wonder why we're still struggling with reading our Bible. And we wonder why we're still struggling with prayer. That's because we don't tap into the Holy Spirit. We're not walking with the Holy Spirit. You guys ever seen Alka-Seltzer? Smell that beautiful smell. What are you wearing today, Alka-Seltzer? Oh, smells great, thanks. And it bubbles over, right? You take that same Alka-Seltzer pill, you keep it in its wrapper, and you drop it into water, what's going to happen? Nothing. It won't bubble up. I think a lot of us Christians face all these areas in our life of difficulty. We want to be victorious and we want to overcome. And we have the Holy Spirit. We are Christians. But we're still struggling with alcoholism. We're still struggling with our sexual addiction. We're still struggling with money issues in our lives. We're still struggling with cheating at work to try and get ahead. We're still struggling with taking advantage of people because we know we can manipulate them. And we step away from all that. And we want self-control. And we want to do better. And we want to be better. But we just can't. We know we're saved. And we're perplexed. Why isn't it going the way we want it to? I think it's because we're not unwrapping, so to speak, the Holy Spirit in our life and unleashing His power. To walk in the Spirit is to wake up every day, moment by moment, saying, God, I'm yours. Do with me what you want. My agenda has been set aside. I take up your agenda. My plans have taken the back seat. You're in the driver's seat. I want to walk in the Spirit. And for some of us, we have got addictions that consume us. And I truly believe this. Mark chapter 9, verse 29, the Young's literal translation puts it this way. There's one word here, the word fasting, that many manuscripts, they don't include here. And I like that the Young's translation did, because in my own personal life, I've experienced God setting me free from things that just consumed me through prayer and fasting. And Mark 9:29 says this, and he said to them, this kind is able to come forth with nothing except with prayer and fasting. I don't like to fast. I don't recommend fasting for everybody. Some people with health issues should not fast from food. They can fast from other things. Maybe their addiction to their cell phone, put Facebook deactivated for a week. Maybe they can set aside watching TV for some time, take on a different type of fast. And when we talk about fasting here, it's not for everybody. I get mean when I fast. I'm cranky. If I don't eat, oh, it messes me up. If I don't get my coffee, I'm back on the wagon, folks. Just I keep drinking coffee. I'm addicted again. I get cranky. I get mean. But I believe that God is saying, you come to me. Here's what we do. You come to God. You walk in the Spirit. You tap into His power through prayer. And maybe for some of you, there's a bondage in your life that's consumed you, and maybe you consider for the first time in your life actually fasting over it. And here's the concept that I want you to see. It's practicing discipline in one area of your life so that God can reveal to you that you can actually be victorious in this other area. It's gaining the confidence of practicing discipline in this area that you can control with God's power, so that you will be aware that He can set you free from the bondage of this other. If you're stuck in this issue of God's Spirit being alive in you to produce in you the fruit of self-control, and you're missing that element to your life, maybe consider coming to God and say, you know what, I'm a fast. And I'm a cranky person, so I'm going to stock up on lots of water and maybe a protein shake and keep the juice run. And I'm going to drink, and I'll fast. I won't eat my calories, but I might drink them. Maybe you say, I'll eat dinner, and then I'll fast for 24 hours where I won't eat anything until the next night's dinner. Find that area in your life where you can practice walking in the Spirit and exercising self-control so that you can gain victory in another. Our friend Eric is not here today. He got called into work this Thanksgiving weekend. We can pray for him and his coworker. They're both Christians, and they need another one or two people to be be hired at their store. So they rotate every weekend so that each of them can go to church. And if you know Eric today versus Eric a year ago, you will literally see two different people. Eric has struggled for his entire young adult and adult life with an addiction to alcohol. At a very early age, Eric got consumed by alcohol, drugs, gang-type activity. And that's how he started his young adult life. For over 20 years, he would repeat that cycle of getting drunk every single day. And this year, God has set him free. He is 225 days sober. God has finally broken the bondage over his life. And I want Eric to share his story with you of how God has set him free. Watch this video. Okay, here we are. Me, Natalie, and my buddy Eric.
What's up?
Eric, what's about to take place?
I'm about to step out of my comfort zone, my own skin, and fly to Florida. I'm about to check myself into a rehab facility for alcohol abuse. A big step I've never taken before. And pretty much put my cares in other people's hands, which I've never done before. Is totally just let go of the entire situation and let somebody else help me with it. So
we're way proud of you, man. And we're praying for you. How do you see God at work in all of this?
If he wasn't in work, I'd probably just not be here. Be waking up to another day of work and going home to the bottle and just being on a destructive path still. So for him to be in work is a simple reason that I am here, about to board a flight.
All right, man. We're excited for you. So proud of you, excited for you, I'm praying for you. Just wanted to hear from you over this journey. What were some things that God taught you while you were away?
One of the things he taught me basically was about giving over full control. You know, struggling on a day-to-day basis with my addiction was so hard. There would just be times where I was breaking down and I couldn't understand why it was that I couldn't get past this. Like how many times I've prayed for it to be taken away from me. And I realized that it's not something that I fully will conquer. It's more kind of like a thorn on my side that I have to kind of accept and then put my trust in Him, faith in Him, that He will help me from day to day. And that no matter how bad it gets, he'll bring me through it. And not to trust in myself and my own needs, which I've always done. And not to manipulate the situation to try to make the outcome the way I want it to be. But trust him that the outcome, no matter how it's going to be, is his plan. And that he's going to take care of me. Something that I need not to worry about tomorrow.
Yeah. Well, man, the Christian life is a moment-by-moment, day-by-day thing.
Definitely.
So is an addiction.
Mm-hmm.
The hope that I find is in Christ. Colossians 1:27 says, Christ in you is the hope of glory. So that's where our hope lies, man. And we're praying for you. And we know that Christ in you, he can overcome what has held you down for so long.
Thank you.
Yeah. All right, man.
All right.
Now let's rejoice on what God did right there, right? 2 years ago, I sat at Jason's Deli, and he said, I am an alcoholic, and I need to be set free. And day after day, and year after year, we tried everything. Maybe you're a family member, and you've got someone who's struggling with some kind of a self-control issue. It doesn't have to be alcohol. It can be something else. And you're thinking, why can't you just get better? I just wish you would do. And so you try and control the situation any way you can. You do whatever you can for them. You give them advice. You give them books to read. You plan things out for them. You try your hardest. You pray so desperately. And you haven't had any success. The victory and the key to seeing someone overcome their difficulties, not trying to manipulate the situation and get the outcome that you desire, you've got to surrender to. You've got to surrender your life to Jesus Christ, to follow Him, to pray. You might consider even praying and fasting for someone in your life that's struggling with this issue. And I remember talking to Eric and saying, Eric, 2 years ago, we started this journey. And listen, buddy, you came to me. I didn't come to you. You came to me wanting to change. It's time for you to let go and let God take over. And because of the tithes and offerings of Anchor Church, we were in a position earlier this year to be able to help financially send him to go to Florida, where a detox would normally take 2 days, but for him, it took him 9 in the hospital before he could even get into the rehab facility. 45 days later, he came out clean. He took in his Bible, not his cell phone. He read that thing from cover to cover and tore it up, and he is not perfect. Please don't think that, wow, Eric is super Jesus now. He still faces struggles just like all of us. But you know what Eric's doing every day? He's resigned himself to the fact that I need God. I need Jesus desperately every moment of my day. Remember that deep theological truth that Jesus could not have sinned? James 1:13 says this, let no one say when he is tempted, I am being tempted by God. You know, a lot of us think that the obstacles, the trials we face, that somehow God's tempting us. Well, no, that's either our own evil desires or it's the enemy trying to draw us away. And it says, for God cannot be tempted with evil, and he himself tempts no one. God can't even be tempted. So what makes the most sense to you and I? Running to our best friend for advice who's struggling and going through probably the same thing we are. Talking to a parent that we think is going to give us wisdom and knowledge. Asking a coworker who we respect for advice on how to overcome this issue. People who are all flawed just like we are. Or instead, running to Jesus and say, okay, God, it's yours now. It's all yours. I need victory. I need your self-control to live in and through me. He might lead you to that godly person to have that conversation with, or that coworker. And if you're seeing and sensing God's people telling you something in your life, that's probably a very good indicator of God's Spirit trying to lead you and help you to be set free. So the story today is a story of victory found in Jesus. We overcome our issues of self-control by walking in the Spirit, surrendering to God, bringing that sheet of paper, handing Him the remote to our life, and praying. Talking to God, even if you feel like you've been over and over and over saying the exact same thing. Praying. And maybe there's some things that we can be set free from through prayer and fasting, where we practice this area of discipline and surrendering our life to Jesus so that he can move in and through us and show us that there is victory, so that we can gain victory in another area. Let's pray. God, we come before you, Lord, and you're the perfect one. You're not tempted by sin. You don't even respond to it in any sort of way that would make us feel like there'd be a chink in your armor. Perfect holiness equals perfect self-control. God, we are imperfect. There's some things we can do pretty good at. We feel like we can pride ourselves in, but when we're honest with ourselves, we've never been 100%. We've never been perfect. And each one of us is not exempt from the issue of self-control. Our struggles and the storyline and the backdrop of our lives might look different than the people that we're sitting next to, but we all need your power and your victory in our lives. If there's someone here today that says, I need to be set free, I want you to do something bold. And where our eyes are closed, and it might feel weird, but I want you to make a line in the sand today between you and God and the people that love you. I just want you to stand up, to stand with me and say, I need prayer. We're not going to poke. We're not going to pry. Just like Eric, if you want to bring that issue up to us, we're there for you. But I want you to stand right now where you are and make a sign of commitment to God that you're willing to surrender to him this area. And I want to pray with you. I'm more than proud of those who are taking that stand. And the reality is, we all know that each of us need help in some way, in some fashion. Lord, I pray that you would honor their bold and courageous commitment of standing and break them free from their struggle. And Jesus, I pray for each of us, Lord, that we could experience the joy of walking in your freedom. Lord, that we could run to the perfect one, and that you'd produce in us your fruit of self-control. Give us victory and give us hope for a transformed life, of a new future, of a no more same old story, but transformation. In Jesus' name we pray. You can be seated. Amen. Well, we're so glad that you're here today. And I do hope that you enjoyed today's message. I pray that you would share it with someone in need. And I pray that you would get the word out.